Good morning. I'm going to talk about punctuation, spacing, typographic articulation as a means to convey hierarchy and meaning and its influence on Malayalam typography in particular. Small graphic marks that we call punctuations are often too crucial in written communications. We quite often underestimate them. Linguists claim that punctuations can actually save lives. Punctuation marks are of a much later origin compared to the origin of phonetic alphabets. Until the invention of printing, punctuations were used differently by different regions. And by different scribes as they wrote books. One of the earliest known system introduced around 260 BC. So used a centered dot, which was called comma at that time, for the shortest segment in a sentence, a lower dot called colon for a longer section, then a raised dot called period for the longer section. So punctuations, again, originally were used as breathing cues rather than to clarify sentence structure or meaning. So you can see in this exhibit that merely dots as punctuation mark work because those times Latin was written only in capital letters. The invention of printing revolutionized the way we write with grammatical structure and use of punctuation to aid clarity in meaning. The advent of printing set standards in the art of typography and introduced punctuation marks as refined non-phonetic graphic marks. They are non-phonetic, unlike the phonetic alphabet, because there is no corresponding spoken sign attached to it. Apart from these graphic signs, typography and book design also introduced what may be called visual punctuation by means of disposition of space and its relationship to form, size, and styles of typefaces to articulate structure and meaning. So the exhibit here shows effective use of space and variation in type to articulate hierarchy. So the same text put up in different ways to emphasize different parts, maybe to suit a particular context. So visual punctuation is all about the relationship among graphic elements and meaningful spaces in a composition. So it's a question of activating the space using the various elements on a page. This paper attempts to examine how Western influence contributed to the introduction of punctuations and visual punctuation in Indian languages in print, with special reference to Malayalam. Languages of the West, particularly English, have had and continue to have considerable influence on Indian languages. Introduction of printing, English education, and availability of printed books from the West all have influenced Indian languages in many ways. Just to show the Malayalam script, it was originated based on Grantha, and it's a syllabic writing system, each unit representing a whole syllable, unlike the Latin, where the letter represents a phoneme. Malayalam script has 52 letters, including 16 vowels and 36 consonants, together making up 576 syllabic characters. The earlier style of writing Malayalam was modernized as of 1981. This new script considerably reduced the number of letters. This was done to bring Malayalam on the keyboards of typewriters and computers. Later, the design of Malayalam typefaces followed this style. Now, as we heard yesterday, there is revival of interest in going back to the older forms and hybrid. I must point out at this juncture that the new script actually takes up a lot more space than the old script. So maybe a book which could be done in about 100 pages using the old script might take about 130 pages by using the new script. So If you are looking at educational books which are printed in lakhs and lakhs of copies, this can have an impact on the amount of paper that we use. Malayalam, like most other Indian languages and languages in general, did not have any punctuation marks to begin with. Peculiarities of the original sentence construction did not require punctuation. The most widely used punctuations are comma and full stop. Since every sentence in Malayalam ended in a finite verb, the sense was clear even without a full stop. Take the case of an example here. In English, Ram, let's say, Ram was bitten by a snake. The order is subject, verb, and then object. In Malayalam, it will be said as Ramane Pambu Kadichu. So here the order is subject, object, and ending with a verb, so that the sense is clear there. When it comes to comma, Malayalam manages by using a suffix called um. So um actually replaces the comma, and it can also replace the word and. So the example here in English, Rama, comma, Krishna, comma, and Gobi together went to forest can be said as Ramanum, Krishnanum, Gobiyum, Kudi, Kattil. So here the comma is replaced by use of the suffix. Parenthetical clauses, punctuation such as brackets and long dashes were originally never used again in Malayalam. Instead, such parts of sentences would appear separately as a full sentence. So the example here, the last one, in English it's possible to say my opinion and a parenthetical clause, whether you agree with it or not, is this. And this will be said in Malayalam. This is my opinion. Ende abhiprayam idan. I don't know whether you will agree with it or not. Adu ningal angikarikkumo illayo ennu enikkarilla. The last part is a compound word. You know, it actually combines four separate words. Ennu enikku arilla. So it's taken as this is again another peculiar form of usage borrowed from Sanskrit. Nevertheless, the influence of the West, particularly the English language, popularized the use of punctuation later. Prose emerging as a popular form of written expression, once again influenced by the spread of English literary forms, was another reason for this, where use of punctuation helped complex sentence structures. One of the early uses of English style punctuation was found in a Malayalam grammar book by George Martin, published 1863. A later book by A.R. Rajaraja Varma called Kerala Paniniyam, published 1893, recommended full use of English style punctuation marks in the construction, particularly of prose. This system, to quote from the book, this system of using symbols which removes doubt and ambiguity in the sentence construction has been accepted by us from English, unquote. He recommended use of 13 symbols, 13 punctuations, and gave them a Malayalam name for each of them. It's very interesting, some of these names. Comma was called Ankusham, semicolon was called Rodhini, and quotation marks were called Udharini. In fact, the punctuation marks are not really known by these names now, except maybe in literary circles. The advent of printing and later the influence of Western media, establishment of vernacular newspapers modeled on the English counterparts, all this gave rise to widespread use of punctuation marks in printed and web communication. Comma, full stop, question mark, quotation marks, and exclamation marks are some of the most commonly used punctuations used in Malayalam. So in the exhibit here, you can see that most of the lines ending require hyphenation because they are all very oddly broken, but still Malayalam doesn't really use hyphenation because some of the things that I have marked in red very badly broken at the end, which definitely need. The other circled elements that you see here, they are italics typefaces used. Malayalam doesn't have a well-designed italics type, so it rather looks ugly, but this is followed from a visual punctuation English convention to set the names of books or newspapers, magazine in italics. Here the names are the name of the newspaper Manorama, for example. So the convention is blindly being followed, but we do not have the kind of typeface to enhance the aesthetic value of such such words. Coming to visual punctuation, the early newspapers in India were established by the British primarily for the Britishers. These provided a good platform for natural adaptation of content, editing styles, form, typography, and production techniques to Indian media industry. In English, and later, a smooth transition of the same to vernacular media. Taking cue from the English typography, many layout strategies were adapted in Malayalam media industry to visually articulate the content. The results are most pronounced in the case of magazine and newspaper typography and design, particularly in the area of magazines and newspapers. One other slide I would like to show, this is a very rare instinct of end-of-line hyphenation used in a Sanskrit text. I don't know when it is printed, it must have been very old, using the Devanagari script. Very rarely do we find using end-of-line hyphenation. Right, so this is an example of the visual articulation, the space, manipulating the space and variation of type to articulate hierarchy. This is done fairly the same way that we find in for example, in English. Here is another example using display type, even a drop cap, and then pull quotes in different sizes, a caption again trying to use the visual, activate the space with variation in typography. This kind of techniques can be found mostly in magazine covers, treatment of article or cover story headings, typographic variation of subheading, intro, special words, use of display typefaces for pull quotes, highlights, etc. Now, let me conclude. There could be a loss and a gain as a result of the influence of Western culture on Malayalam languages in print. Certainly the West contribution to Malayalam typography and its voluntary adaptation have been very valuable. Use of punctuation has indeed helped in experimenting with interesting and complex sentence structures and expressions in native languages in the hands of creative writers, while visual punctuation helped to create quite interesting and engaging layout. So we can see that the use of spacing and typographic variation as a means to convey structure and hierarchy has universal appeal, much beyond any cultural barrier. Gestalt loss of perception being the underlying universal principles here. With reference to effective use of typographic variation, vernacular typography still need to go far to capitalize on this account. Many more typical text typefaces and specific italic styles have to be designed, and also specific punctuation marks to go with each of the style. On another note, Indian languages do not have the capitals or small caps as we find in the Latin. Probably, English typography can borrow this feature and set running text using only lowercase. Here is an example of a book, in fact, I'll come to that. This exercise actually can save quite a lot of time and energy by avoiding several keystrokes while typesetting and formatting books. Another big advantage could be that it could relieve editors of publications from the capitalization nightmare. Actually, Chicago Manual of Style devotes quite a lot of section of pages just on sorting out the issues on capitalization. So probably editors could use that time for something more beneficial. Here is a book which was designed by me almost a decade ago, and this book on Rajaji from cover to cover uses just lowercase letters. And I was able to convince the author by saying that, you know, this was done as a mark of respect to Rajaji's simplicity, which is talked about in the book, so the author was really convinced about that, and there was absolutely no issue for anybody to read this. I tested it even before actually printing. Copy editor had a lot of problems with it, saying that no, this is not allowed. But people reading, maybe those who are very familiar with reading Indian languages, never had any such issues of reading this. So this is something really possible. At the same time, I want to also say that capital letters in English is so beautiful in form. Actually, the whole inspiration for the classical typefaces came from the Roman capital, so you cannot really afford to discard them. So I would suggest that probably capitals can go as display big typefaces, which will reveal the beauty of the typefaces, and keep the text as only lowercase. The body text as lowercase. This probably can be an Indian contribution to the world. Thank you very much.